want our coffee in the lobby. We watch our worship on the screen. We got a rock star preacher who won't wake us from our dreams. We want our blessings in our pocket. We keep our missions overseas. For the hurting in our city, or would we even cross the street? But we want to see the heart set free and the tyrants kneel. The walls fall down and our land be healed. But church, if we want to see change in the world out there, it's got to start right here. It's got to start right now.
Dear God, our hearts are broken for this world. The hatred is palpable, the division undeniable, and the pain runs deep. We desperately need more of you. We ask for your truth to be louder than the noise which surrounds us, for your mercy to be stronger than the voices of oppression, for your strength to overpower those who seek to do harm. Where there is division, bring unity. Where there is anger, bring peace. Where there is evil, bring victory. Empower us to fulfill your mission, to answer your calling, to be the light you've created us to be. May your love, your grace, and your mercy flood this world. We love you. We seek you. We place our hope in the mighty name of Jesus. This we pray.
Welcome. I think I have my thing on today. I've been messing it up the last few weeks, and I'm thankful that I figured it out so we're not messing up the microphone. A beautiful day outside. It's getting a little cloudy, but it was so nice this morning. I walked, and I was walking outside after I prepared my sermon, and I was just like, man, this is a blessed day. It's such a beautiful day out, and it was just, the birds were chirping. It's just like the whole world was happy in that moment. And I think about when the Lord made this day, how it creates a happiness in us to come and to worship Him. I'm thankful that we have that opportunity. A couple announcements. The first one, I talked to a couple board members this morning, and I just wanted to relay this to you. The church is no longer going to require you to wear a mask. If you feel like you want to wear a mask, you can. We're not going to laugh at you if you have one on. In fact, we'll encourage that if that's what you feel is what you need to do. But based off what the CDC said, if you've been vaccinated, you don't need to wear a mask. I'm not going to ask for your vac card. You're not going to have to wear a badge or something saying that you've been vaccinated. But starting this week, you will not have to wear a mask if you don't want to. So it's been a little over a year since we can say that. I'm thankful that maybe we continue to move toward normalcy. And I'm thankful that today that we can sort of take that next step. And, you know, if something would change, we may have to go back. I don't think we will, but, you know, we'll always monitor that. So I just wanted to give that announcement. Also, Tuesday night Bible study, Wednesday night prayer meeting are both going to be this week. Again, you can come live if you would want to, but most people seem to like the fact that they can do it on Facebook. But if you would like to come and sit in the pews, give me somebody to speak to. I wouldn't mind that either. So feel free to come. We still haven't really... pushed any buttons forward to go to a Sunday night Bible study again, but we are starting to look at that possibility. If you have any thoughts about that, let me know. And also the youth is still at in the noontime hour. They may be moving back to the evening. So both those could happen soon. And I believe if I listen to my wife, which I typically struggle with, if you ask her, I think the women's Bible study is starting this Thursday on the 20th. And that's at 10 a.m., Connie, you're shaking your head? 10 or 11. If see Jeanette, I know that those that get together that time are truly blessed, and I don't know where they're going to be at. I don't know if they're going to start at something new. Not sure yet, but if you want to sort of feel some more normalcy as women get together and enjoy Bible study together, talk to Jeanette, and I think it starts this week. I think that's all the announcements. I'm sure there's other things that I'm forgetting, but I think that's all the announcements. Are you excited to be here?
Amen.
Why don't we stand up and we worship the Lord with Dawn?
Good morning.
Thank you.
We come to the time of the service where we recognize the power of prayer. I don't know if you heard the helicopter out there. I don't know if you got it on your phone, but we have a missing 12-year-old. I think he has autism. And let's make sure that we keep that family and him in prayer. Don't know the circumstance, but let's keep him in prayer. I also wanted just to thank you for your prayers. My mother came through her surgery Monday. Things went well. Thankful that she had it. I mean, sometimes when you have surgery, you're like, well, what did that accomplish? But if it wasn't for the surgery, she would have been at a risk, a very high risk of having something horrible happen. And I appreciate for continued prayers, but she's doing really well. My father's doing as well as he can, and both of them are recovering from having stents put in their heart in the last 4 or 5 months. So just keep in your prayers. It was amazing to see God put a calm over her because she was really nervous Monday. And I talk about this often. There is this peace from prayer that only God can provide. There is this peace that we should, you know, praise the Lord over, that we should worship Him over. If you don't feel peace, go to Him. And here's the value, is that the reason that we worship and celebrate in prayer right now is because that peace is for all of you. It's not like you have to come to me to get peace. It's not like that only certain people get peace. It is amazing when Jesus came, the angel said, peace is what the first thing that came out of God's declaration when Jesus came to this earth. He said, peace. Jesus came for peace. Prayer gives us peace. And in those moments when you are in the middle of that struggle, if we are willing to pray, or as in James 5:16, if we are willing to go to others and ask them to pray with us, if we are willing to say, Lord, I need you right now, there is peace because there is hope. What I'm so thankful for, I serve the Almighty God that is the solution to everything. That is why I have peace, is because of Him. Because I know that He hears our prayers. I know that He is the answer. And I know this 12-year-old, whatever's going on, that God is there. And I know He was there for my parents. And I know there's many healing right now, going through things right now. He's there for them. And I'm so thankful that I can stand before you, because otherwise, if I didn't believe that, I could crumble before you. For all the pressure of this world, for all the things that are going on this world, if there was not the hope and peace of Jesus Christ, how could any of us stand? If you're online and you have a prayer request, you'll just put it in the comment fields. We will pray over it. Here, there's cards in front of you if you have a prayer request. If you'll write it down, we'll pray over it this week. If you'll just put it in the back or hand it to me directly. And just by a raise of hands, are there unspoken prayer requests? Yeah. So many. Let us go to the Lord in prayer for all these. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you right now. Lord, we lift up what those hands represent. We lift up the comments that are on Facebook. We lift up this young child, Lord, as whatever's going on, that there is a solution. We lift up those right now that are in anxiety. We lift up those there's uncertainty. We lift up those that are trying to heal or having health problems. We lift up those that are having family issues. We lift up those that are down and out, but they are never forgotten by you. And we know right now that you have promised us that you hear our prayers. We may not always know how to pray. We may not know the right words, but you know exactly what needs to be done. And we rely upon you right now. We stand upon those promises. We stand on the rock of Jesus Christ as we say together, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And they all said, amen. Let's stand and worship again.
Good morning. Today I'm reading Ecclesiastes 3, 1 through 8. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace.
We all said,
amen.
You can be seated. Well, you know, our last song was to somewhat to test whether or not you were a hick or not, right? So, I mean, I don't know how many of you said washed versus wash. Not sure which you said. I was singing washed, in case you were wondering. I caught myself about three times. Oh, you said washed again. You know, it doesn't matter how you pronounce it. You know, have you been washed by the blood of the Lamb, or have been washed by the blood of the Lamb? What an important understanding as a Christian. We don't have to clean our garments. And I love the song reminding us of that, that God will clean us as white as snow. Today, my title of my sermon is Gifts for You. There was a talk show host that would go around, and many of you know who it is when I say this, but she would say, a gift for you, and then she'd go, a gift for you, and a gift for you. Today, I suggest that we celebrate a gift for you. This week leads up to the day of Pentecost, which is a Jewish festival, and if you know me very well, I love to preach about the Jewish festivals, because I think there's a lot of meaning behind them that as Christians today, we can understand. Now, there was this great pastor that I sat under for a long time that would teach us that all the festivals except for one have been fulfilled by Jesus, and that there's only one left, and that's what he believed, and I think he's convinced me that it's probably true. I don't know that, you know, I would fall on a sword for it or anything like that, but he said the only festival that's not been fulfilled by Christ is the Feast of Tabernacles. And if you go to Zechariah chapter 14, you will see this end of time, this eschatology of that. But if I keep going down that path, we'll never get done preaching. Today, the Pentecost was fulfilled by Christ. Now, the Pentecost in ancient Israel was put in place to celebrate 50 days after Passover. And what they celebrated was the first fruits, that at this time in their calendar, they started to have a harvest. And I believe the celebration was given to them to remind them that God created the harvest. He created the olives trees, and he created the plants that created the fruit that they were able to then use in their daily lives. So he created the olives. He also created the environment for them to grow and to flourish. You know, plants don't grow without certain things. Take your like I have tomato plants, and I've got marigolds, and I've got cucumbers sitting inside right now, because if I'd have set them out last week, they would have died. But also, if I'd have left them inside, they're up against a window. Why are they against the window? Because if I'd have set them in a dark room, they would have died. They would have never flourished. But God creates this environment for the fruits to happen. And then finally, he makes them bountiful. He makes them bountiful. So when they're celebrating the Pentecost, they're saying, well, God created this, God made it so that it would happen, and he blessed us with a bounty, a resource. And that festival never changed from Exodus until Jesus ascended to heaven. But on that day, on that wonderful day of Pentecost, which will be celebrated next Sunday, but as this week leads up to it, on that day, God sent the Holy Spirit to the church. And the celebration shifts from this physical harvest. We can still thank God for all the resources that He's given us. I think way too often we do not recognize this is from God. You know, when we get a paycheck, I think often we look at that paycheck and say, look what I earned, not look what God has given me. If we recognize that God has given us the fruits and the resources, it's important. But on this day, on the Pentecost day, the celebration changes to the harvest. The harvest. The same harvest that Jesus proclaims is coming in John chapter 4, 35b and 36. Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes, look at the fields, for they are already white with harvest. And he who reaps receives wages and gathers fruit for the eternal life, that both he who sows and he who reaps may rejoice together. See, the day of Pentecost was the day the church was born, and it was formed not because it was some kind of society thing. You know, it wasn't the society of people that like to get together and sing songs. It's not the society of people that like to get together and talk about how great Jesus was a teacher. It was not a society of we just like to get together because we love each other's smiling faces. The church was built for the harvest. The church was purposed for the harvest. God created the church. God gave it the ability to have a harvest. And God blesses the church with the bounty and the capability of affecting others in the harvest. And because the church is equipped, you are here today. I as I said last week, when one of my favorite verses is Acts 8:36, and I didn't give this to Scott, but I just want to say this again. When the Ethiopian eunuch says, how can I unless somebody teaches me? You would not know Christ if it was not for somebody else sharing Christ with you. You could not have become part of the harvest unless God had created the church, gave it purpose, gave it ability, enabled it to do the things that He wanted it to do, and to give you an opportunity to see the wonders of Jesus. Is Jesus wonderful? You know, I think some days, you know, we can just say amen. I think days that we have come through the valley, it becomes something more. When we know that He stood beside us no matter what. But you know, if you think about how the Pentecost happened, Jesus is getting ready to head up to heaven. And He tells them, I want you to wait here, and God is going to fulfill all the promises. And when He fulfills the promises, then you'll know what to do. And you may say, well, what promises are we talking about? In John chapter 16, it starts in verse 7. The whole chapter's interesting. I'm just going to pick a couple verses out for time's sake, but I want to make sure that we understand the promises. Verse 7, it says, nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away, for if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send Him to you. And verse 8, and when He has come, He will convict the world of sin and of righteousness, and of judgment. So one of the promises that Jesus talks about in John chapter 16 is that, hey, I'm going to have to leave at some point. And when I leave, I'm going to send somebody to you. We'll call him the Helper, which we today call the Holy Spirit. And when I send you the Holy Spirit, he will help you just as if I was helping you. See, I think one of the things we miss in the Holy Spirit is, you know, there was an advantage of being a disciple, right, an apostle. At least we see it as such. Could you imagine getting to walk with Jesus on this earth? Could you imagine getting to walk alongside of Jesus? Could you imagine what it would be like to be able to say, yeah, what about this, Jesus? What about that? Why is it this way? Why is it that way? Could you imagine getting to turn to Jesus? And I think when he recognizes that, it's going to be more difficult one day because I'm not going to be here. That is when he has to give us this promise that the Holy Spirit can act in the same manner, that you can ask questions, that the Holy Spirit will help guide you through issues that you may be going through. Now, unless there's somebody here that's very unique, you probably would love to ask a few questions to Jesus. What about this? What about that? And yet, his promise was, if you wait until the church is born, I will send the Helper, the Holy Spirit. And when I send the Helper, the church will be enabled to help. See, there is, in that alone is a great blessing of the Pentecost. There alone is one of the great blessings that you must always remember, that God, for some reason, and I don't know why he did it, is that he assumed as us, as the church, that he wanted us to help. So he sends us a helper so that we can be able to help. And if you think about all those wonderful church moments, whatever they are in your mind, if you look down deep inside of them, what you will see is the Spirit helping. How we are brought together in fellowship so that when one person is struggling, there's that great song, right? When one cries, we all cry. When one laughs, we all laugh. When one is hurting, we all hurt. Do you feel that way? That's because of the day of Pentecost. That is because of that day. It goes on to say in verse 13, however, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you things to come. And he will glorify me, for he will take of what is mine and declare it to you. You want to know the truth? Allow the Holy Spirit to work in your life. You want to understand the blessing? Allow the Holy Spirit to work in your life. You know, there's some churches that want to suppress the charismatic side of God. But God sent us the Holy Spirit. God sent us the Holy Spirit so that we can be the helpers. And on that day, we become equipped to work in the fields to harvest. I think way too often we think of only certain people being equipped. But according to the day of Pentecost, according to what Jesus said, he didn't say, hey, look, I'm going to send a couple people the Spirit that they can be. No, he sends the Holy Spirit to us all. He sends it to his church. not this physical building. He sends it to you and to me and to all of us so that we can become laborers of the harvest. And from this wonderful moment, two of many promises are fulfilled that I wanted to highlight today. So the first one is, He will guide you into all truth. You know, truth is such an enigma in this world. Most people will say, can you even know what is true? Watch the news. I don't care what your favorite channel is. And tell me that you don't have some doubts of what is true and what's not true. I don't care what station you watch. I don't care where you get your source from. It's difficult in this world because truth seems to be an enigma. In fact, if we remember Pilate when he's talking to Jesus, what does he famously say? What is truth? I mean, in other words, what he was saying is, well, you say your truth, but does anybody really know what truth is? And as soon as you feel like, well, I understand truth, I understand everything, it's easy for me to understand that, the world just laughs, sends something at you, and you're like, well, maybe I don't understand. See, truth is like a riddle wrapped up in a contradiction, never truly to be understood. But we are given a helper. And Jesus says this in John 14:6, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. In other words, you don't have to wonder whether or not you know what is right or wrong. If you're following Jesus, it is the truth. Notice he says, I am the way. The way to what? To what is true, what is righteous. The question is, and I think why we struggle with truth and we make it into a riddle, is that often we are not looking for God's truth, which is righteousness. We're looking for all these other truths. We're trying to figure it out in our mind. We're looking for some kind of formula that will answer. In reality, the only answer is Jesus Christ. The only answer, the only truth is Jesus Himself. And He is the way. And I will tell you, when you are struggling with those riddles in life that are contradicting everything that you understand. I mean, I've had some people ask me questions that are unanswerable, except to say, I know Jesus, and I know He is the truth and the way and the life. And that if we trust in Him, things will get better. Whatever it is, things will get better because of Him. If we will just trust in Him. Secondly, there is this promise to equip us for the harvest. And this equipping is what Paul calls gifts in 1 Corinthians 12. And we could sit and take each gift and try to explain it, but I don't think we need to do that today. What I'd rather do is try to give you some of the gifts and then show you how they all have a similar common denominator. So here are the gifts. One is wisdom. Another is knowledge. Another faith, another healing, another working of miracles, another prophecy, another discernment. Some apostles, some prophets, others teachers, some with the gift of helps, and the Bible puts it as helps, and others with administrations. Each of these gifts are related by verse 11, but one and the same Spirit works all of these things, distributing to each one individually as He will. And then in verse 7 of 1 Corinthians 12, for the purpose of, in verse 7, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. Now I wanted to sort of think about, what does that mean? Why are we given gifts? So I titled this sermon, you know, Gifts for All, or Here's Your Gift, Here's Your Gift. But why are we given gifts? You know, why is somebody given the gift of teaching? Why is somebody given the gift of being able to console people, to pray for people? Why is somebody given the gift to sort of have discernment and prophecy of what the future will hold? Why are those gifts given? Why is somebody able to sing so beautifully? What are the value of those gifts? Unless it is for the profit of all. Not the profit of you, not the profit of this church, not the profit of just this community, but the profit of all. The reason we are given gifts, the reason that we are able to fruit, the reason that we are given the ability on the day of Pentecost to access the Holy Spirit is for the profit of all. If people are not benefiting for our gifts, then they're not profiting from our gifts. People should be able to say they are so gifted because of how people are treated. Are we dispensers of hope? Are we dispensers of joy? Are we dispensers of peace? Do we love till it hurts? Do we love when it's impossible? That only comes from the gifts that we are given from the moment that the Pentecost was fulfilled. I really often get frustrated with people, and I don't mean it in a negative way. I hope it's a pure way. But I always just want to say, no, no, no. When somebody says to me, I don't have anything to give. I have no gifts. I have no capabilities. I'm not enabled to do anything. And I always say to myself, well, if you have the Holy Spirit, and what we are promised is that if we surrender to Christ, that we will receive this Holy Spirit, then we must have gifts. You may not understand them. You may not know how to utilize them. You may have to pray about it. You may have to go about and say, look, I'm willing to take whatever step it takes to use them. I'm not going to pick on any one person, but there was a person in this congregation today that could not read their Bible in front of anybody and could not pray. But now she uses her gift. There is no such thing as I cannot if the Holy Spirit is being used and accessed. There is no such thing as I cannot. I would try to do the Yoda thing, but I'm not a Star Wars guy completely. But he says something like, there's no try or something like that. I'm not going to do it right. But I will say this. If the Holy Spirit is in your life, you can do anything. And I always say it with my own heart open. And I've said this many times to you, and I'll try to say it as quickly as possible. When I worked at Xerox, I was very successful. And my boss came to me one day and said, if you could just ever public speak, if you could just ever learn how to speak in public, you could write your ticket to anywhere. But you can't. 5 years later, God calls me into ministry. And I stand before you trying to speak. And I say that for this reason. There is no, I can't do that if the Holy Spirit is in us. We don't like the word supernatural because it's been hijacked, right? We think of witches and ghouls and all kinds of stuff. But the true definition of supernatural is what happened on the day of Pentecost. You became greater than your nature. Supernatural. In other words, what you thought your nature was, what you thought you were capable of, the Holy Spirit can take that and blow it up into something that you could never imagine for yourself. The imagination of God is so infinitely greater than anything we can imagine for ourselves. When I hear people downgrading themselves, I always say to myself, if they could just get a hold of the Holy Spirit, if they could just grab hold of Him, God will put in them a work that they no longer will be able to downgrade themselves. That's what happened on the day of Pentecost. That's what happened on the day of Pentecost, is in that moment, when it was fulfilled, that we begin to have the capability to be greater than ourselves. You want to know how to become selfless? You first must become greater than self itself. Because what happens when the Holy Spirit makes you greater than self itself? You no longer believe that it is you that is the impetus to great things. And so I will tell you, and I proclaim to you right now, that all of you, if you will rely upon the Holy Spirit, have gifts beyond any imagination that you have right now. And I'm not talking about everyone needs to stand up here and preach. Everyone needs to teach a Sunday school class. In a different scripture, it even says that one of the great gifts that the Spirit gives you is encourager. Can you just be an encourager, a supernatural encourager? Could you imagine what this world would be like if we had more people that encouraged instead of discouraged? I want you to think about what is going on in this world today. What amazes me is one of my favorite football players in college is Justin Fields, and he's now going to play for the Bears. And it was amazing to me this. I saw greatness in him, and I still do. But there were people out there, before he ever takes a snap, they were saying how horrible he was going to be. And then there were others that are lifting him up, only waiting for him to fall. Especially in sports, but in the world in general. The world will try to prop you up so your fall is greater. You're the king is only said to you so that one day they can laugh at you when you crumble to the ground. We are professional discouragers unless we have the Holy Spirit in us. And then all at once, and you know who you are, you will come up to me and say, you know, I know that this is difficult, but you're doing a great job. And there's this lifting of my spirit because you could tell the genuineness of that statement. So all of us, I tell you all, you have gifts. Whether you're using it or not, you have gifts. Now, I think often we say, well, is that really a big deal that I'm not using my gift? And I thought I would, in light of our Bible study, which is in the King area right now, you know, I think we're just sort of ending up David on Tuesday nights and Solomon in that area. I thought maybe we would use Solomon as an example of understanding about gifts. So Solomon prayed for God, and God said, well, what do you want? He said, well, I would love to have double wisdom. And if I had double wisdom, that would be great. And God gave him double wisdom. Whatever double wisdom is, I don't know how you multiply wisdom. But in other words, he had a lot of wisdom. He had so much wisdom that, and so much insight that everything from knowing how to make the crops grow better to making your spouse happy, he had the wisdom to tell you how to do that. Now, I don't know which one you think is easier, growing crops or making your spouse happy. You have to choose that on your own. Both of them are amazing in their own ways. But he wrote, theoretically, he wrote Proverbs with all those Proverbs in it. He wrote the Ecclesiastes that Scott read today. He wrote the Song of Solomon. He perhaps even wrote Lamentations. And so this guy had so much wisdom, so much to impart. It says in the Bible that he was able to not only profit for us, profit for others, those of Israel, but every neighboring country benefited from his wisdom. In fact, there's a story where the Queen of Sheba comes and asks him questions. And so his wisdom was so great that he could untangle riddles for the common man all the way up to kings and queens. He had this great gift. But I don't know how many of you have read Solomon's story. It doesn't end well. He had this great gift, but he quit applying it in his own life. Instead, he started to, part of the thing is, I don't know if this is a wisdom thing or not, he had 700 wives, 300 concubines, and a whole bunch of other women. So he had like 1,500 women. I don't know if there's any wisdom in that. You can decide whether that there's wisdom there or not. But because of that, he needed to satisfy, excuse me, sound like alfalfa there. He needed to satisfy some of his wives, so he started to build altars to other gods. He starts to worship other gods. He starts to deny that God is the only source of wisdom. He starts to choose not to rely completely on God. Why? Because perhaps, you know, he had become so wise that he thought he was greater than God. Now, I know you never have been in that circumstance, right? You've never chosen to say, well, what I believe is greater than what God believes. Never happened in your lifetime. Except for maybe just that once, right? There is those moments when in our rebellion to God, and I'm not saying that everybody has rebelled to God, but I will tell you, many of us have. In that rebellion, what we really are saying, my understanding is better than your understanding, God. And Solomon was doing the same thing. I know what is best here. I got to keep my wife's happy, so I got to start doing this. I got to start building temples. He was building temples next to the temple. He was saying, it's okay now, we'll build an idol over here. Well, now we'll build this over here and we'll build this over here. How in his infinite wisdom he thought that God was going to be pleased with that, I don't know. In 1 Kings 11:6, it says, and this is God speaking, Solomon did evil in the sight of the Lord and did not fully follow the Lord as did his father David. Where he done evil was is that he did not use his gift for the glory of God and for the benefit of others. He started using his gift for his own benefit, for his own self. And it comes to this in 1 Kings 11:11. Therefore the Lord said to Solomon, because you have done this and have not kept my covenant and my statutes, which I have commanded you, I will surely tear the kingdom away from you and give it to your servant. And as we go into our Bible studies in the next week or two, we're going to see that the Israelites, because of this, divide into two different kingdoms. The northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. And because they are divided, they are conquered. And they have dealt with consequences from that moment of 1 Kings 11:11. To this very day. Go turn on your favorite news. What is going on? The Israelites are dealing with the consequences of Solomon choosing not to follow God. And in that division and in that conquering, they deal with that. With however you interpret what is going on over there today. There are people dying today because of that division. There are people dying today because the gifts that God had given Solomon, he was not willing to use in the glory of God. So how does that relate to the church? And I close with this thought. How does that relate to the church? And this is going to sound harsh to you. And I don't mean it that way. But I only know one way to make it sound important enough. If we do not use our gifts, there are people right now outside these walls dying spiritually. If we are not using our gifts to benefit those around us, there are people right now that are driving down 173rd that are dying because we are not willing to reach out to them with our gifts and to begin to help them see Jesus Christ for who He truly is. If we would just reach out and begin to enable the Holy Spirit in our lives, perhaps one of them would not die. The horrible spiritual death that is destined for them otherwise. Why the day of Pentecost was so important is that if we are willing as a church if we are willing as a church to take the gifts that God has given us and to use them accordingly, we can become a place of salvation, of life, of hope, and of peace and joy. Is that not why we are a church? Perhaps this week you could speak to the Holy Spirit. You could pray to God and say, how should I use my gifts? Do I have any gifts? And can you give me the courage and the strength to use them however you wish me to use them? That is why we should and always will at this church celebrate the day of Pentecost, because it gives our church purpose. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you right now. And Lord, I don't know if there's anybody praying with me, but I'll pray for myself. Lord, whatever gifts you have given me, may you strengthen and give me courage to use them in the benefit of those around me. May they find you. May they find your hope and your peace. May they find a new joy in you, Lord, because I was willing. And I hope that maybe others are praying that right now, that may say, I don't even know my gift, Lord. But help me be a benefit to others. We thank you that you fulfilled the Pentecost. And we thank you that you are willing to strengthen your church so that we can be laborers in the harvest alongside you. Lord, bless each person as they go today. May they feel your presence all day long. May they sense the joy that is to know you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We are like clay, static, unrecognizable, nothing. A formless mass with no direction, no purpose, no meaning. We are like clay, pliable, movable, moldable. In the hands of the Creator, we can be changed, made beautiful, given life. Nothing becomes something extraordinary. The transformation takes time. The process is tedious, difficult, painstaking. But soon we see the beginnings of something wonderful. The formless takes shape. The unrecognizable finds its identity. The meaningless is given purpose. From nothing comes beauty. We are like clay, each piece different than the next, given unlimited potential in the hands of the potter.